Welkom at deze presentatie. Ik spreek een beetje German, Duits, but I will do this in English. I'm Peter Martin. I'm from Holland. I'm from Nijmegen. That's about a 3.5-day walk here. We are here now. And the music you just heard, did anyone know this track? Can I see hands? No one? Okay. It's Amon Tobin. In 1997, he released an album called Bricolage, and the track Stony Street was the first track I heard, and I got hooked to this music. I really love it. It's electronic music. And I wanted to have more of this kind of music. So I was looking at the internet, and there was no place where I could find information about Amon Tobin. Only a couple of lists, but there was no complete list. So I had a list on my website. This is my website back in 1999. I had this website. It was for Internet Explorer 5, optimized, 800 by 600. And I had this nice looking stat. And I could see the statistics. And I had this list of Amon Tobin records that I wanted to collect, and also the ones I already had. And I noticed a lot of traffic on the the list of Amon Tobin records. So I decided, well, maybe I should create a discography of it. And by the way, back then, my name now is PE7ER, but then it was PETER, but I changed it. Anyway, I had this website, PE7ER. You can't see it over on the top. No, it's not there. But this is just a list of records of Amon Tobin. The list grew and grew because I collected a lot, and I also added new stuff on it. And back then, something else. Back then, you didn't have Google, so I had to use other stuff like Hasta La Vista to find stuff. But I collected a lot of information about it, and the page grew, and it grew so much that it took too long to load. So I had a solution. I just cut the page in two. It's not really a solution, it's a workaround. And I was thinking about, I had to learn something like PHP MySQL, and I will create my own website, and I can put all the information just in a database and let people decide what they want to see. And this is means basic course. This is where I started, PHP 4.2. And I created a website with it. But then I found this website, open source CMS. Who knows this website? Here I discovered Mambo. And Mambo was great. They call it power in simplicity. And with Mambo, I will start this trip down to memory lane. Who used Mambo in the past? Okay, who started with Joomla 2.5? Okay, cool too. The people who started later with Joomla, this you all missed, all this horrible stuff, all the things we have to go through. Mambo, this was one of the default text in it. This is the version I started with. When you install Mambo, you can install it like this. Just like Joomla, you have a sort of overview with all the things you have to do. You had to click accept license, otherwise you couldn't progress. So you had to agree with the license. It was forced. You could install sample data just by clicking this. It's the same with Joomla, only now you have more screens. And of course, my favorite username password, I use it on my local machine, and this is what you get. And what I really loved about Mambo was you had a CMS where you could put information in, and the information would just be displayed to visitors. But you could also create your own components. So I created this discovery component, which was just in this website, and I didn't have to create a database connection anymore because Mambo did it for me. I didn't have to take care of the layout because Mambo did it for me. And even user login, I could log in into the backend, add new records, and I didn't have to take anything about logging in into account. This was my foundation for the application. So how would you install a website in a Mambo website, a new article? I mean, how would you write it? First, you had to log in. Then you had to choose static content or dynamic content, which was called all content. OK. Let's first do a static content. So you get these buttons, really difficult to read, except when you hover those. Then they would light up. And when you click new, you can add stuff. But I want to have pictures. Well, you can have pictures. Just select some pictures, and you have to click some buttons, and then you have a MOS image tag in your content, which would display the picture. Not really user-friendly. OK, I have this page. And now I want to have this page in the menu. I mean, I want to have a button to display the information. So you go to the menu manager, create new. And now you have to really be careful. If you chose the wrong menu option, you had to remove it and create a new one. You could not change it like you can now. In this case, I just created static content, so I had to create a static content link menu item. This is what you do. I just clicked it. And to create it, to create a new homepage, to put it on the homepage, we just had to put it on the first position. So the first position is the homepage. This is what you get. But I loved Mambo because of the extensions. If you had to install something like a component, easy. Just go to the component menu, select your component, and install it. Okay. What about modules? Easy. You go to another menu called modules, say create new, and you have to install it. Okay, what about what we call plugins these days? Back then they were membots. You do the same. So it was weird. I mean, you had to decide what would you install and then select the menu to install it. Nowadays, you just have one component. You use Joomla's installer, and Joomla looks inside. Okay, this is a module. Chuck, you don't have to choose that anymore. It's just inside. So this Mambo, it was really easier to make the website. It was easier than HTML. And I thought, OK, I was working at the company for 3 days a week. And yeah, I want to do something with Mambo. I want to create websites with it. My username was PE7ER. Really difficult to explain to people. So I had to choose another name. And please don't look at the PE7ER.com website. Please don't. The DB8 website, I mean DB8 is my name of my company, meaning databases behind websites, and you have infinite possibilities. And on the 1st of January 2005, I started my company. It was called DB8, and I created Mambo websites and OS Commerce web shops. And well, everything went well. And on a beautiful summer day in August, I was really glad that I didn't think about a name with the name Mambo in my name, because in 2005, in August, this happened, the split. The core team behind Mambo, it was all volunteers, and they didn't like the way that the commercial company was doing stuff and maybe trying to influence everything. So they thought, okay, let's split, let's start something new. We call it Mambo, Open Source Matters, because we think open source matters. And we just start something new. And then they start something. They had a form without a name, just Open Source Matters. And on the 1st of September 2005, the name Joomla was announced. They had a logo competition. They released Joomla 1.0 in 70 of September. And a couple of days later, they had the logo. So Joomla 1.0, 3 years. It has an end of life, a lifetime of 3 years. Installation, exactly the same as Mambo, almost. Only different colors. Login, same. This was improvement, because now they had content items management and static content management. OK, let's create a dynamic content and all content. You go to the content items manager, you create a new content, and now you have this. The buttons are better readable here. And this is also really nice, apply. The first Mambo version I had only save and cancel. So when you want to see the result on the page, you had to save, then open the article again, and then make any changes. In this version, you had to, when you had to want to create a read more in an article, just add some text over here, and the rest of the text over here. And this was the read more text. So if you have the long text, and you want to have some stuff to the first part, you had to copy paste things. It was really difficult. And this was Joomla 1.0.0. No logo, because they didn't have a logo. A couple of days later, new logo, new layout. Great, except this. This was really horrible. Borders, tables. I mean, everything was layout in tables. And back then, you didn't have layout overrides or template overrides. So everything you changed, with a new update, you had to change it again. In 2008, the new Joomla was announced, 1.5. And Joomla 1.5 looked a bit similar like 1.0, but there were differences, like you had just one menu to install everything. However, when you installed it, you still... you just installed the package with one installer. They got rid of the double text messages. You just had one text area, and you could press a button to have a read more. And this was the front end. There were still some components, like I think the contact component, which had tables in it. But some of it, you could create template overrides for it. And this, for you Germans and for us Dutch, this was really nice. You could put the back end of your Joomla website in another language. So no more the default English. You could choose Dutch or German or whatever. From code point of view, 1.5 was really an improvement because they started with the model view controller. However, they started with it, and only the weblinks component and the comedia component were ready with MVC. Everything else was just two files. No MVC, but it worked. This was a major improvement. You could create template overrides. And I know there was today there was a nice presentation about layout overrides. This was the beginning. First you had template overrides, now you have also layout overrides. One thing. A lot of people had 1.0 websites. What to do with those? Well, they came up with the idea about compatibility. So they had a legacy mode, meaning you could install some Joomla 1.0 components in your Joomla 1.5 website, but the code was really of the 1.5 was much bigger because it had to support the old 1.0 as well. And well, yeah, it's not the way forward. In 2011, there was one major improvement in a project. Who knows what this improvement was? Sorry? Besides that, Roland joined, another improvement. Okay, Git. Before 2011, the Joomla core team used SVN as a code repository and code, how do you say it? A code system to work together with code. Sorry? Versioning system, yes. And since 2011, the Joomla core code is just in Git. And you can help out with the code just by creating pull requests or help out with testing. So it was easy to cooperate. And you will see that in the improvements in Joomla, because they get faster. In Joomla 1.6, it should have been named 2.0, in my opinion, because of the changes. It was so much different from 1.5. It took some while to create it. Does anyone know how many beta versions it took for 1.6? Yes, but how much? No, not that much. 15. And one release candidate.
Not enough.
Sorry?
Not
Yeah. Anyway, it looked better. And a couple of major improvements, this was the first. In 1.0 and 1.5, you had sections and categories. So if you wanted to create an article, you first had to create a couple of sections and categories and then articles. And since 1.6, you could create nested categories. So categories within categories. Something else, if you create your own components, you can use Joomla's category manager, com categories, with your own component. Just add this URL with com messages in the backend of your Joomla website, and you will start Joomla's com messages, which doesn't have any categories, and you will start the category manager, and you can create categories for your messaging system, which you cannot use because there is no category ID in the messages, but you can do it with this. So it's really nice if you create your own components, use this one to create categories for your components. So yeah, the category manager, just one instead of two. Something else was, we already had different languages now in the backend and the front end. So you had language packs. But to create a website in different languages, you had to install something like Joomfish, which was a bit difficult to learn, especially for customers. So this was really nice. From 1.6, you could create language codes. I mean, use language code in your language, in your articles. But also, instead of the public registered special groups, you had a large ACL system, and you could create your own groups and levels. And if you were doing stuff with articles, the batch modus really improved a lot. So that's about 1.6. 1.7 had something else, the one-click install. It was really much easier to install Joomla or update Joomla. And in 2012, Joomla 2.5 arrived. And Joomla 2.5 had a couple of new, like you could also update extensions using this. It had a database layer. In the past, all code had MySQL hard-coded in the content, I mean in the code, and now you could use things like MSSQL. This was also nice. Before this version, before 2.5, if you didn't like read more, or lees meer, and you wanted to change it in someone else, maybe in an exclamation mark behind it, you could do it. But with an update, it could be overwritten. Since 2.5, you can create language overrides, just like template overrides, but then for language strings. Oh, and of course, you could install languages from the backend, so you didn't have to download it. You just go to extensions, languages, and then install German. 3.0, it was released in 2012. Major improvement, of course, the backend became responsive. So if you would make this smaller, everything would change and you could still work with it. The front end had built-in CSS, a framework called Bootstrap. So if you use this is the protostar, you could do the same. In 2.5, you had the language included in articles, but there was language included, but since this version, you could, associate articles with each other. So if you, in the previous versions, you do it with menu items. So you have a menu called home, and you could create it to another one, but now you can do it with articles. If someone uses your search, and they find an article, they click it, and they want to know the language, it's really easy to do. And of course, the database layer. 2013, something really, really important happened. Before this, it was really difficult to test patches. And in 2013, someone, I think, yeah, maybe a couple of people from the PLT, released the patch tester component. Who has not used this one yet? Okay. Recently here in Germany, there was a pizza box of fun. I think 180 people? 105 people? 105 people participated. With these pizza bugs are fun. If you participate with it, you learn how Joomla's bug system works, you learn how to test patches, and you learn new functionality of Joomla as well, because sometimes you read tests, and then, hey, I didn't know this functionality. It's really nice to participate with it. Anyway, if you install Joomla and a patch tester component, you get something like this. On the issue tracker on GitHub, you see information about the bug and the testing procedure. And when you test it and you can reproduce the bug, you just click here, apply patch. You try to reproduce the bug again. And if you see that the bug has been fixed, you can write a report and then refer to the patch. And then you can do something else. And this is really easy to test. Now I will show a couple of different versions, because this was already maybe 8 months later or so. Joomla got tags inside. So instead of just one category layer, you had multiple association possibilities. And Joomla 3.2, it was already mentioned today, it got two-factor authentication. Who didn't get the UB key yet? No, who didn't? Who did not? Oh no, you should go to, I forgot his name, a couple of rooms there, because it's really great for your security. And of course, Joomla got versioning. So if you had an article and some of your clients messed it up, you could just revert it by going back a couple of versions. And for the developers here in the room, this version got a framework, so it was easy to build rapid applications. Now, last year, 2014, 3.3 arrived, and 3.3 had something which is called Make Microdata. And microdata is really, really great. For instance, if you have an article which is about ratatouille, what's it about? Is it a recipe? Or is it a movie with a little mouse? If you look at this side, this is HTML. HTML is just, there is some sort of hierarchy in it, like H1 is really important. But what is Peter Martin? It was 18 September. A search engine doesn't know what it is if it looks at your page. But if you add microdata to your HTML, you add context to the HTML. So if a search engine indexes this with microdata, it will see the date, which is specified here, and here's just a label of this is the microdata. And every part of the page will get a context. And this year, 3.4 arrived. The new Google CAPTCHA was integrated. But what about the future? I mean, the current version of Joomla is really great. If I think back all those years, a lot of improvement have been happened. But the future of Joomla. Well, I will just tell something about the future of the internet. First of all, there is a large increase in mobile web. That means a lot of people are using mobile phones, smartphones, to look at the internet. And if you look in the world, I think maybe 40% of the world population uses the internet. So 60% doesn't use the internet at all. And in the emerging markets, like India, Brazil, people are not using laptops or desktop PCs. They are using mobile phones to visit websites. And if you use mobile phones to visit websites, you don't want all the stuff, like HTML, all the large pages, like with large images. So there are a couple of trends, I think, that will happen. First of all, you don't retrieve HTML sites, but data, only data. And your application will use the data in some way. And I will tell something about web services in a second. Something else is big data and open data. Big data is data storage is really cheap these days. So people just gather information, data. They don't throw it away, but they can analyze the data. In the past, they had to do inquiries, like statistical analysis. And now they have just real-time, one-to-one information about everything which can be stored. And another thing is open data. I don't know if how it's here in Germany, but in a couple of countries, governments are releasing data. I mean, they use tax to gather all data, and now they see, okay, we get this data with public money, so the public should be able to access the data as well. But data itself is worthless. You have to know the context. Linked data, I will tell you in a second. And finally, you have hardware miniaturization and the Internet of Things, and I will show that in a minute as well. So, web services. If you go to Google with a browser, you're going to the web server. And if you go to the web server and you put down this address, you will get a map of this location. But if you go to another URL, to the web service of Google, and you put in the exactly the same information, you will get this back. This is data. This data is structured in a format called JSON. And you can use this in other tools, in other mobile applications, or maybe on other websites. Or if you have a map, you can get all these kinds of coordinates and just put coordinates on one map. That's how all those applications work. But JSON itself, what you see here, it's nice for one application. But what if you have three or four different sources that give JSON output to you? How could you use it? Well, they call it JSON linked data, LD. And just what microdata does with HTML, adding context to HTML, can be done with JSON as well. So this is just JSON, like something is an ID, something is an author, a date. But here, it's linked data. I see the date is wrong, I think, the format. But anyway, here, there's a website called schema.org. And because at schema.org, there's a type created called article, if you know this, you can combine it with other data. Finally, I like to do stuff with the hardware. I don't dare to create clocks. I didn't bring a clock with me today here. But I do stuff with electronics. And this little chip, it's a really small board with 8 pins on it. It's called the ESP8266. I don't have anything to do with this. I mean, I'm not in a company selling these stuff. But this might be one of the things that might give a boost to the Internet of Things. Because this, with this, you can connect to the Internet. If you have a small device, you can use this to connect to the Internet or to let your router connect to this device. So you can maybe switch your lights on and off with it. Or what I did, this is a transistor. This is a converter, and here you have a battery pack with 3 batteries. And this converter converts the 4.5 volt to 3.3, because this is 3.3. I replaced the firmware on this machine, on this chip, and this one will retrieve it's a sensor. So I could use this to measure the temperature. And I had this website called thingspeak.com. It's a website where you could put your data to. You can send your data to it. It's a web service which you can use. And here, this is the temperature in my garden. Only it was not really that good, because 84.8 liters, the battery got flat. So it's not really that good now. So, well, this is 10 years of progress. I think Joomla improved a lot, about usability, functionality, multilingual, safety, etc. And I hope that the next 10 years, Joomla will improve even more, because the rate of improvements is really fast, not only with Joomla, but all with technology. But Joomla has the same. OK, thank you.